So let's now have a look at another example of computing the partial trace. This example is quite simple. Namely, we want to compute the partial trace of something that is already a product state. And to be consistent, namely that applying the partial trace over B of something that is actually a tensor product, so in fact, it looks like this. We expect to get back row A and nothing else. Let's now first have a look at method number one of computing the partial trace. Remember that method number one of computing the partial trace can be applied whenever you've already written row AB in terms of some tensor product. And we do this by applying the trace not to the A part but to the B part. So in this case we would be computing row A tensor the trace of row B, but because the trace of all quantum states is 1, this is just row A as promised. So let's see that the same also works for the second method of computing the partial trace. So let me remind you what that method looks like. So this was the rule of computing the partial trace. So if I plug in here row A tensor row B, then on the A part I'm just applying the identity, and on the B part I sandwich it with the little b's. Or in other words, I get something that looks like that. Where here I've done nothing, applied the identity, and here I put it in between the b's. So let me now take this row A and put it outside. So we have row A tensor something that looks like this. So you might want to convince yourself that in fact this here is again just 1. And one way to convince yourself of this is actually to use the fact that the trace is cyclic in reverse. So let me write this here as the sum over B, the trace of this term, because remember the trace of a number is just a number. Now using the fact that the trace is cyclic, I'm going to move this B over here. So this gives me sum over B, trace of B, B with rho B. Now because the trace is linear, I can move this sum over B inside. So I have the trace over sum over B, all the B's, rho B. But because we're measuring, of course, in a basis, the sum over all basis elements of this form is the identity. So again, we end up exactly in the same place as before.